just brings its questions. When trusting you becomes to wrestle, I have resolved it. No matter the cost, I'll follow. These earthly wells have left me thirsty. Up empty, only your word and only your way I'll follow. What a joy it is to follow Jesus. What a gift it is to bear his name. What an honor to choose surrender and make him my everything.
We are continuing in Proverbs, so you can turn in your Bibles to Proverbs chapter 6 this morning. It's an awesome chapter, and I so enjoyed preparing for this. You can just see God's wisdom in these words and warnings that we'll be covering. Sarah can attest that as I prepared for this, and the more and more time I spent trying to narrow it down and cut this sermon down, the more I wound up just adding things to the sermon. So I'm grateful that Cheryl was able to get it all on one page for you guys. And I won't go any longer than Pastor Craig does over the next hour. The youth don't think I'm joking. As we study this morning, and throughout this whole series, I hope that you'll pray and find ways that you can apply this wisdom to your life, not just for your own benefit, but as a Christian, when we study the wisdom of God and apply it to our lives, we magnify and glorify Christ as he proves his wisdom through our lives lived out in obedience to him. This chapter has been called Five Ways to Avoid Wrecking Your Life, as it addresses five sections or poems that Solomon warns against. So we're going to look at the tangible, physical, and tactile anatomic descriptions that Solomon uses to help us visualize these dangers that we face as we look at the anatomy of a fool. When I mentioned that title, a few people offered to stand up here as visual aid, but instead we'll just have our little man with us on the screen, and he's not walking on water despite the background. So let's look at Proverbs chapter 6, verses 1 through 5. My son, if you've put up security for your neighbor or entered into an agreement with a stranger, you have been snared by the words of your mouth, trapped by the words from your mouth. Do this, my son, and free yourself, for you've put yourself in your neighbor's power. Go, humble yourself and plead with your neighbor. Don't give sleep to your eyes or slumber to your eyelids. Escape like a gazelle from a hunter, like a bird from a hunter's trap. So it's the word given in hasty, unwise security and the hands struck in thoughtless pledge that bring us to the first point on your notes, the snaring mouth of the fool. And this is Solomon's warning against surety. Think about the day and age without credit scores and bank statements. Your word, your reputation was your bond. Your reputation as being trustworthy was your verification within the community. And so Solomon's implicitly warning here, don't put your own reputation on the line for someone else. Don't vouch for the financial dependability of either a neighbor or a stranger. And the Hebrew word here used for the security of a neighbor is sometimes translated as surety. And it means in this sense to put yourself on the line in a pledge for someone else. And so trapping or snaring yourself by the word given in surety, we see the snaring mouth of the fool. And I want us to understand that in this context, it's not exactly like loaning somebody money or even co-signing a loan, but in modern financial terms, this would be like guaranteeing someone else's open line of credit in your name. Imagine a situation where someone comes to you looking for a little bit of financial help, and instead of providing them with money, you open a credit card in your name for their use. Does that sound like a wise plan? Imagine your neighbor starts a business and asks you to use your house as the collateral in the small chance that it may fail. Sound like a solid plan? So this warning is against what can start as a desire to help or uplift someone else, but ultimately it's rooted in naivety at best and pride at worst. So because of this situation being described, it's standing in the gap between someone else's financial responsibility and putting your own credit on the line for them. Theologian Adam Clark from the 19th century put it this way in his commentary: "If thou pledge thyself on behalf of another, thou takest the burden off him and place it on thine own shoulders. And when he knows he has got one to stand between him and the demands of law and justice, he will feel little responsibility. His spirit of exertion will become crippled." So see how this is talking about standing in the gap of responsibility and how this actually weakens, not heightens, the sense of accountability because it's been reduced. So financially, it's improperly lifting responsibility, limiting accountability, and taking on what is not our responsibility. But I also want you to see how it's the placing of oneself into the neighbor's power. Or as the ESV states, you have fallen into the hand of your neighbor. Because as you have lifted your responsibility from him, you've also put your own livelihood, your own reputation, into his untrustworthy hands. So in other words, this person who initially can't be trusted to manage their own affairs has now also been heaped upon your reputation, your responsibility, what really belongs to you has been placed upon them. So you can see how this is a doubly unwise trade of responsibility. And as you take his responsibility, you place your own responsibility into his hands. So does this limit us from paying on someone else's behalf? Does this mean that all forms of agreements or debts or ventures or investments are ultimately unwise? Or does this limit our ability to provide or financially care and bless others? It doesn't. Consider two examples in the New Testament that help clarify this for us. Number one, think about Onesimus. You remember Onesimus? The runaway slave who had run from his master, and he met the Apostle Paul and he put his faith in Christ. Paul then wrote to his master, Philemon, saying, if he has wronged you at all or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, write this with my own hand. I will repay it, to say nothing of your owing me even your own self. I want you to see the difference of what Paul is doing for Onesimus and what Solomon is describing to avoid. Bible scholar Derek Kidner puts it this way, very succinctly: the New Testament shows us Paul accepting Onesimus' past liabilities, but not his future ones. So there's a difference here. Think of the second example, the Good Samaritan. Remember the story of the Samaritan that found the man on the way to Jericho on the side of the road, and he took him to the inn, and he pledged 2 denarii to him, and he pledged whatever else was needed to his care, to the innkeeper, he would take care of it when he returned. Notice, I want you to see that he guaranteed his care, not his character. So I hope you can see the difference there in the ultimate warning, but three principles that we can draw out from this behind the warning and how the snaring mouth can trap us. And what this warning against surety is all about, on your notes: blindly trusting in the character and responsibility of another without evidence to support that trust. Next, it's thoughtlessly agreeing to excessive financial responsibility on another's behalf without the means to do so. And third, it's pridefully making financial decisions today based on foolish assumptions about tomorrow's prosperity. Let's talk about a real-world example, as you consider those, that has affected all of us. The 2008 subprime mortgage crisis that was a major factor in causing the multinational financial crisis in 2008. I graduated as a finance major from college, and this was a huge topic of study. So think about our principles there on the screen. Wasn't it the surety of banks to offer loans to unqualified people to buy houses that they couldn't afford so that those banks could turn around and strike pledges with investors over these loans because they had such surety that the housing prices were just going to go up and up and up and up? And then they turned around shocked when all of these people defaulted on their loans and the banks were left with thousands of properties that were now worth significantly less than what they'd originally offered in loan. Do you see the principles ignored? But surely, you know, this dusty old ancient book has nothing to say about a 21st century modern economy, right? Wrong. God's word and his wisdom do not change. And so while this is a very specific situation that's being described by Solomon, this teaches us principles that can be applied to a much broader set of situations. I'd say all manner of financial situations that we more commonly find ourselves in. So applying that, we should be careful on your notes, be careful what you commit to and beware of financial entanglements. Beware of the snaring mouth. Jesus taught us the foolishness of making rash oaths, but simply letting our yes be yes and our no be no. James picked up that theme in James chapter 4 when he said these words. Come now, you who say today or tomorrow we'll go into such and such town and spend a year there and trade and make a profit, yet you do not know what tomorrow will bring. What is your life? For you are a mist that appears for a little time and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. So our response to this warning should be to remove ourselves from the place of pride and the illusion of control, which is where our foolishness stems from. And that's all it is, isn't it? I mean, we don't know what tomorrow holds, so what kind of promises can we truly make? What kind of agreements can we strike? And so this pledge of surety becomes, I'm going to cast my livelihood, my family's livelihood, upon another person who cannot bear the weight of such responsibility. It's putting your faith in either yourself and your evaluations and your judgments, or it's putting your faith in someone else. And so our surety, the one that we place our livelihood on as Christians, the one that we place our faith in, should always solely be Jesus Christ, who became surety on our behalf. So that the only surety that we should have is our surety in salvation by faith in Jesus Christ and trust in the Lord's will and nothing else. So you can see the urgent danger that this foolish financial entanglement represents, as Solomon says, go, humble yourself, plead with your neighbor. Don't give sleep to your eyes or slumber to your eyelids. Escape like a gazelle from a hunter, like a bird from a hunter's trap. He's calling to the same action and urgency that a trapped animal reacts with. Solomon says to find a way out, find a release from this pledge through humbling yourself, pleading and begging, possibly the same tactics that were used on you to get you into the loan. Plead and beg. Now that can be humiliating, but it's better to be humiliated than to be utterly destroyed and destitute. The imagery that the jaws of this financial trap are ready to close in around you, and that you shouldn't even sleep until you found a way to settle this foolish entanglement, that means it needs to be handled today. It's such a good warning because we can see how financial entanglements have absolutely ruined people's lives. It's a very pervasive and now a very subtle danger in our culture. Look at this slide of the average American debt. Now, ignoring even mortgage payments and car payments and maybe school loan payments, the average credit card debt is about $20,000 for a household. And usually that's very high interest debt. And we put off debt like it's not a big deal, but it's the same debt that gives us so much stress and so much anxiety and often leads us into even more foolish financial entanglements. Proverbs 22:7 says that the borrower is slave to the lender. I wonder how many American Christians are enslaved to financial fear and pursuing the things of the world rather than being urgent about God's wisdom and financial freedom so that they can focus on pursuing his will and working for his kingdom above all else. So what do we do with that? Well, in humility, we need to ask God to help us take responsibility and find freedom from foolish financial decisions and entanglements. We need to seek God's wisdom in this area, and we need to act accordingly and urgently. Next, Solomon addresses another obstacle that may be directly leading into foolish decisions, or it can keep you from doing anything about them. And that's the warning against laziness. Look at verse 6. Go to the ant, you slacker. Observe its ways and become wise. Without leader, administrator, or ruler, it prepares its provisions in summer. It gathers its food during harvest. How long will you stay in bed, you slacker? When will you get up from your sleep? A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the arms to rest, and your poverty will come upon you like a robber, your need like a bandit. So we have the folded arms of the fool. And such an interesting advice to this slacker son that Solomon's addressing. You just know that he's writing to his teenage son that won't clean his room, right? The one who won't get out of his room and go outside. I imagine the go to the ant part is, why don't you actually leave your room today and go outside? Get some sun. Or maybe you don't even have to go. Maybe just lean over the bed and you can watch the ants that have now infiltrated your room and they're eating the leftovers under your bed. It's awesome imagery. But see, rest is not the problem. The problem is the slacker neglects his responsibility and pursues rest in the time of work. The reality is laziness is not just an issue for teenagers. It's a pandemic for our society. And we have to be careful not to push this warning off onto other people, but allow God to expose the areas of our laziness and our overindulgence of rest and even the improperly prioritized pursuit of rest in our lives. And I'm willing to bet that if most of us were honest, it wouldn't be hard for us to find a project we've put off or an area of our lives where arms are folded when they need to be busy at work. Have you ever planned a relaxing vacation? You go all through the vacation, and by the end of the day, what do you sometimes feel? By the end of your vacation, what do you sometimes feel? Tired. You feel tired, and the only thing you can think of is, when I get home, I need to just rest. I need to rest from all the rest that I've taken. How does that work? Or maybe you've experienced the 15-minute nap that somehow very quickly turned into 2 hours. Or maybe the planned 7 to 8 hour night that you woke up and it'd been about 10 to 11 hours and you usually don't feel refreshed or energized. You usually feel just more tired, but now you have a random headache. So over and over, Solomon gives the exceptionally deep wisdom that the rest of the hard worker is sweet, but the lazy man tosses and turns in his bed. So understand, it's not about rest, because laziness often leaves you feeling even more exhausted. So the problem is the improper prioritization or even idolization of rest that comes from not having a biblical understanding of work. So to really combat laziness, on your notes, we have to have a strong theology concerning work. So let's understand biblically that, number one, God ordained for mankind to work. Work existed from the beginning, before the fall. So work is not the curse. God made us working creatures. So part of the lesson of the ant is to see a working creature fulfilling its function, working. It's to see work in action. And secondly, we need to know, as redeemed mankind in Christ, that we serve Christ in our work. Colossians 3:23 through 24 says this: "Whatever you do, work heartily as for the Lord and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ." For the ant, there's no leader, administrator, or ruler. There's no one watching over to make sure it meets deadlines, fulfills its promises, meets expectations. So the lesson of the ant here is to see a creature that simply works according to its creator's purpose, free of compulsion or greed, and by doing so brings glory to God. There's no thank yous or celebrations or employees of the month at the ant colony. It's just honest, hard work for the greater purpose. And so ultimately, like the ant, we need to know also that we work for a purpose. On your notes, the church should be like an ant colony, both individually and as a body, to be busy going about the work of the kingdom. That's our purpose, to labor for the kingdom. Rest is not the problem. God made rest, but the ant works when it's time to work and rests when it's time to rest. The problem is laziness. On your notes, laziness can pervade and rob every area of our life. When God gives us a gift, we're to always steward it. So our response should be to work hard for, to care for, to provide for, and produce and excel in all that God has granted us to steward. So I want you to see here that Solomon is addressing the problem of laziness concerning physical work, but we need to understand that laziness can manifest itself certainly in our work performance, even if it's not physical labor, but also in our care, our intentionality or lack thereof for our family, toward our church, toward our relationships, and even our relationship with God. Listen how Solomon describes the slacker in Proverbs 10:26. "Like vinegar to the teeth and smoke to the eyes, so is the slacker to the one who sends him." Did you notice that it was the slacker's excessive excuses that gave us folded arms. A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands. Just a little more. Just one more excuse. Just 5 more minutes. Just one more day. I'll handle it tomorrow. I'll do it next week. It's the excuses. But we need to apply this warning also to our spiritual laziness and our spiritual excuses. Spiritually folded arms that are not busy leading, serving, teaching, caring, and pursuing the Lord's people, Lord's kingdom. So just as you assess your physical laziness, also assess your spiritual laziness. Are you being diligent? Are you being a slacker? No person in here would sit idly by while an armed man rushed at you or your family to take everything from you, and yet we sit apathetic as our overindulgence of rest or seeking escape when it's time to work robs us of our wealth, our witness, our relationship, and our fellowship with God. Look at the next section, verses 12 through 15. A worthless person, a wicked man, goes around speaking dishonestly, winking his eyes, signaling with his feet, gesturing with his fingers. He always plots evil. With perversity in his heart, he stirs up trouble. Therefore, calamity will strike him suddenly, and he'll be shattered instantly, beyond recovery. This gives us the winking eyes, the signaling feet, and pointing fingers of the swindler. So I want you to notice the progression of thought so far. You have the situation of someone else's character that's been addressed that could maybe seem to exploit you financially. And the warning against blindly trusting another's character, that's the snaring mouth. And then you have the lazy man who produces nothing because he doesn't put in any work. It's the folded arms. So now we move to this malicious swindler. And this malicious man is often the result of these two warnings put together in a person. Irresponsible and lazy. And through that, they have to prey on the hard work and earnings of other people. They have to siphon off from them to sustain themselves. And it's interesting because in this description of the swindler, there's the explicit warning to avoid him, but also the implicit warning to not become him, to not be like him. So to Solomon's sons and those who would read this wisdom, there's a warning here to beware of this kind of person, but to not act like him in any kind of way. So the use of these terms involving motion is symbolic of manipulation, misdirection, and trickery. The connection to earlier is that the swindler will often prey upon another person's compassion, hoping to snare them while being in a state themselves of constant need or greed because of their own laziness and lack of production. So they siphon off others by tricking them and manipulating them. They've always got something in the works that you don't fully understand. You can't see the whole plan. There's always something behind the trickery and the misdirection. There's motion and gestures and signals to keep you from seeing their true motivations and intentions, which come from a perverse heart within. This is a foundation built upon manipulation and mistreating others for your own gain that is a sure way to experience destruction and devastation. James, in the book of James, calls out the rich Christians who have deceived others, and he says this in James chapter 5. He says, "Behold, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud, are crying out against you. And the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on the earth in luxury and self-indulgence, and you have fattened your hearts in the day of slaughter." That proves this truth, that calamity and destruction cannot be tricked. The end result of a perverse heart is ruin, as the swindler themselves is swindled. The swindler's first and last victim is themselves. They deceive themselves and ignore God's wisdom and go into this way of life only to find ruin at the end. This could be a con man. This could be a salesman. This could be a politician. This can be an influencer. Sadly, this can be a so-called pastor or evangelist or prophet. This can be a family member. And how painful it is when it is. Or worst of all, this can be you. And this can be me. When we act in a way toward others that's deceptive or manipulative for our own gain, that's not in accordance with the truth. So as Christians, there should be no hint of deception among us, No hint of exploiting others or misleading others or speaking in half-truths or being passive-aggressive or sarcastic or hiding behind jokes that have hidden meanings. Listen to what Solomon says about that in Proverbs 26. Like a maniac shooting flaming arrows of death is the one who deceives their neighbor and says, "I was only joking. It's just a joke. It's just a prank." As you sling flaming arrows of death, that's not who we are. Look again at verse 15. Therefore, calamity will strike him suddenly, and he'll be shattered instantly beyond recovery. The swindler's end is ruin, not prosperity. You know, there's a story that the early church father Irenaeus, who was a disciple of Polycarp, who was a disciple of the apostle John, told about John. And he wrote down this story that had been passed down from John to Polycarp and now to him. As John and Polycarp one day in Ephesus entered a bathhouse, there John saw the false teacher, the swindler, named Cerinthus. And immediately he rushed out and said, "Let us fly, lest even the bathhouse fall down, because Cerinthus, the enemy of the truth, is inside." I wonder if he had this verse in mind, thinking about his destruction. Let's look at the next section and start with the first verse, verse 16. The Lord hates six things. In fact, seven are detestable to him. Let's stop there. This section stands as a warning of engaging in the very things that God hates. And when a list of what God hates is given, you should pay very close attention. If we're to love God, then we should hate what he hates and deeply internalize and even memorize the truths of God. We see here his absolute disdain for the practices listed here. But understand, too, that Solomon is not just warning about these things on the list, but rather he's warning about the hatred of God. The warning is to not transgress into this territory of mistreating others that God finds absolutely disgusting and hates with his very being. This is Solomon ultimately warning against God's hatred. Verse 17 has the first, arrogant eyes. Your translation might say a proud look. The ESV says haughty eyes. Benji says bad eyes. Because even a four-year-old is capable of haughty eyes and will look at you a certain way when they're in trouble. In the Hebrew, this word means to be high or exalted or to rise. So it's eyes that are risen, eyes that are exalted. It's actually used normally to describe items, like the ark being lifted up, or like the exalting or raising of a pillar. But here it means lifted eyes. It's the look that your child gives you, the look that I mentioned Benji is capable of when you discipline them. That's not a look of remorse. It's a raised look. It's a look of someone who believes in their heart in some way that they are exalted and higher than you are. And this is the attitude that either says or believes, "Do you know who I am? Do you know who you're speaking to? Do you know what I could do? Who are you to question me?" It's the student or the person being trained, the inexperienced one who believes they already know the answer and they have nothing to learn from you. The training's a formality. They're already doing the job better than you are. It's the teenager who already has life figured out. They don't need another lecture from you because, after all, they know more than you do, right? Haughty eyes. It's fascinating that even when the mouth stays silent, you can see the rise in the eyes. It's the eyes that see authority as only an obstacle. They see authority as only an obstacle that's in their way, and they see wisdom as old and tiresome. My mom used to use that wording with us. She'd tell us we had a haughty look. And man, I thought you just couldn't win with my mom. Because, you know, you'd say something and she'd say, "Don't say those words to me." And then she'd say, "Don't use that tone with me." And then she'd say, "Don't look at me that way." So the safest thing for me when I was in trouble, I felt like, was just to keep quiet and just close my eyes, right? Just say nothing and hide. I remember one time that I was in trouble and being corrected, and I was thinking what all kids think from time to time. Just make it through this lecture, right? Just got to survive. You just got to make it through. Don't say anything. But my look must have been pretty bad because in the middle of it, my mom just stopped. And she said, "You're looking at me with haughty eyes. I hate it, and God hates it. Go to your room. Man, that'll put the conviction right in you. Go to my room, and I mean, talk about guilt. My mom was in the early service, so we've settled this all out for the most part. Next on the list is a lying tongue. It's extremely straightforward. This is a liar. Your lies, big and small, are hated by God. And it's frightening how fast we use lies to cover up lies, and we use lies to justify our lies, and we lie to ourselves about our lies. Lies beget lies. They multiply. You'll notice how lying is actually brought up twice in this list of what God hates. And how often we see this sin as like an entry-level sin, right? Like it's no big deal because everybody lies. We always lie. And then we look at this list of what God hates and we see it twice. And it's the sin that we think is not really that big a deal. And we are lying to ourselves so that we justify the heart that doesn't care about what God hates. Speak the truth. Next, we see hands that shed innocent blood. These are violent hands. This is the unjustified shedding of blood. This is hands that destroy and hurt and devastate those to whom that kind of treatment is not due. These are hands lifted in harm and abuse to another. These are hands used to threaten and push. These are hands that represent uninhibited violence toward others and that victimize the innocent, the undeserving, those unwarranted to face such violence. There's countless examples of this in our culture. But think about the violence being committed on those who should be protected. Think about the blood being shed in our country of those in the womb. The violence being perpetrated on those who are literally the most helpless in our society, who should be protected and cherished as a gift, and how instead they're receiving harm, violence, and death. Make no mistake that God hates the shedding of innocent blood. Verse 18 reads, "A heart that plots wicked schemes." This is the scheming heart of the fool. This is premeditating sin. This is devising plans for sin and for tricking others and trapping others. And see, schemes are often devised with the plan of not being caught. This is planning, plotting secret sin that you think no one will see, no one will know. And here the Lord reminds us of his inability to be fooled or deceived, his accounting of every evil intention of the heart, and his hatred for the heart that regularly purposes itself for sin and wickedness, especially that seeks to ensnare, harm, or sin against others. And also we see next, feet eager to run to evil. It's impulsive feet. If he's already addressed premeditated sin, he's going to address also the sin that comes from the thrill of the moment, sin that results of being just caught up in the emotion or the fault of not thinking before you act. And this is the opposite of Joseph, who when he was tempted to sin, his feet were hasty by running out of temptation rather than rushing headlong into temptation. So we know that in every temptation, God provides us a way of escape. But these are feet, or this is the attitude that rather than seeking a way out through endurance, seeks a way in through indulgence. It's the passing impulse that you convince yourself just couldn't be resisted. These are feet ready to rush into any temptation that presents itself. And it's even the planning that says, well, I'm not going to sin this time, but in case I do, I'm going to make a plan. It's preparing to fall into temptation. We see next, verse 19, a lying witness who gives false testimony. The ESV says, a false witness who breathes out lies. As easy and as naturally as breathing, lies come pouring out. These are lies specifically about others, about things that have happened. This is speaking falsely about something or about someone else. These are lies visited upon others. The final culmination of all the things that God hates and the final abomination before God is one who stirs up trouble among others, among brothers. And that's a divisive spirit. The divisive spirit seeks to divide and conquer. The Hebrew here of stirring up is the same as sowing seeds. Someone who by their nature and by their actions or their attitudes or their words, they enjoy stirring up people against one another. And sometimes, maybe they don't even intend to. Maybe it's the person who doesn't really intend to cause issues, but by a foolishness or either pride or inexperience, plants seeds of doubt and division among those in relationship with one another. In youth, we call this drama. And I always tell youth when they tell me that they hate drama, I always tell them that it signals to me that it's a red flag that you cause a lot of drama. Be wise and protect yourself from this division in your family, in your relationships. Be wise and recognize any drama-causing or divisive spirit that you may have through your words, your actions, and your attitudes. We look back on this whole list. We supplement this fruit of human nature, this list of who we are, with the fruit of the Spirit through seeking Christ. And this list, just thinking about a biblical example where you see all of these played out, every single one of these things on the list. I thought of the crucifixion of Jesus. And yet as all of these things that God hates, these abominations before God, are being brought against his only Son, Jesus prays for forgiveness for those acting in every aspect identical to this list of what God hates. In that, you can see the grace and the mercy of God as love covers sin. Every time I read this list, it just leads me to repentance because I see myself in the list. It also leads me to rejoicing over God's grace for us. So for him to not only give us forgiveness, but also shower us with the treasure trove of wisdom in his word to lead us into life in his name, we have to just accept how our lives would be in ruin without him and his wisdom. So we put all of this together today, and we have the anatomy of the fool. It's a life devoid of God's wisdom. We see the warnings as God's people of utter and complete foolishness and the beauty of his wisdom. The next section of verses, Proverbs 6 closes by this warning of the burned clothes and scorched feet of the one who plays with fire, the fool who engages in sexual immorality, lust, and adultery. Trent will be speaking on this topic next week from chapters 5 and 6 as he covers chapter 7. And this morning we would see Christ and his wisdom as the opposite of our foolishness. As the culmination of all wisdom, we can embrace him, we can follow him, we can obey him. And in that we can experience life in his name, both eternal life and abundant life today in Christ. We're going to take a moment. I want to ask you to pray and ask God to help show you the areas that you need to apply this message today. We'll have leaders at the side if you need to talk or pray with someone else. But right now, let's take a moment and respond. And I'll close in prayer, and we'll have a video and a quick announcement. Let's pray. Father, this morning, we just thank you for your wisdom. We thank you for how real your word is and how it cuts down into our hearts and exposes our sin. And Lord, we just ask forgiveness for our foolishness. We thank you for your patience and your steadfast love for us. Father, if our salvation rested upon our wisdom or our ability to do everything that you said, Lord, we would fall so immeasurably short. Thank you that it rests on your faithfulness and your character. Thank you for being our surety. Lord, I pray that just as a congregation, as individuals, that we would allow you to search our hearts, that you would try us and test us and evaluate and show us any wicked way, any activity or action or habit that's sinful, that you hate. Reveal that to us, Lord, that we might be closer with you. We might be a people that display your glory and your wisdom in Christ. Thank you for this truth this morning. Thank you for your word. Thank you for your presence here with us. And we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.